food outside and with
and
yes, exactly. You and I know this. So I want to welcome everyone to the Fall 2022 Dean's Global Forum at NUQ. The Dean's Global Forum here features eminent leaders from academia, the media, the arts, and public affairs who, in conversation with me, address enduring issues and pressing matters, but also share insights about their personal lives and their career trajectories. Before introducing our guest, I'd like to thank, first of all, our partners from Qatar Foundation for being here with us, and also from partner universities. I want to thank our communication and public affairs team, our media production team, facilities, and the Dean's Office for working out all the logistics for this event. And I want to welcome today's guests. We are very honored to have you with us today, Ayman Muhyiddin. So I'll say a few things about you, try not to blush, and then we'll start the kind of conversation that we had earlier this morning. Ayman Muhyiddin is a distinguished Egyptian-Palestinian-American journalist and the host of the MSNBC primetime show Ayman. A distinct and unique voice in U.S. journalism, Ayman began his career with U.S.-based NBC News as a desk assistant in the Washington, D.C. area. His first major assignments happened shortly after 9/11. We'll talk more about these. And he has said that his knowledge of the Middle East and the Arabic language has provided him with unique opportunities. Over the past several decades, he has reported for NBC, for CNN, for Al Jazeera on major conflicts around the world. Wars in Iraq, in Syria, in Libya, the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, sectarian strife in Lebanon, protests in the Ukraine, nuclear tensions on the Korean Peninsula, so on, so forth. In the aftermath of the 2003 Iraq invasion, Muhyiddin was based in Baghdad for CNN and was among the few journalists allowed to observe and report on the U.S. handover of Saddam Hussein after he was deposed. He also produced Libya's Gaddafi's exclusive interview on abandoning, relinquishing the WMD program in Libya. He also worked for Al Jazeera during the Egyptian Revolution and was detained twice by the military. Time magazine named Ayman as one of the 100 most influential people in the world in 2011. And he has received multiple international awards. It'll take me about 10 minutes to list all of them, but I'll mention a few. They include the Peabody, Sigma Delta Chi Award, Argentina's Perfil Internacional Press Freedom Award, the UK's Cutting Edge Media Award, and the European Union Anna Lindh Foundation Award. He has also been named Journalist of the Year by a motley crew of journalists. Ayman Muhyiddin, welcome to NUQ. We're honored to have you. So here's how we'll proceed. We'll talk a little bit about Ayman's life, his trajectory, how he got involved in journalism, his life between the Arab world and the United States. Then we'll move on to maybe talk about a few career highlights that you can share. We have a lot of journalism students in the audience. And I also want to discuss at the end some issues in global journalism, U.S. politics, some of the stuff that I saw you talking about last week when I was in the U.S. And so tell us a little bit about, so you're the son of an Egyptian father and a Palestinian mother, and you arrived in the U.S. at age 5 in Michigan, yeah. Right? Tell us a little bit what that felt like.
Sure. Well, first of all, let me just say, Dean Crady, it's an honor to be here, and thank you so much for inviting me. It's a real privilege to be able to speak at the Dean's Global Forum here at Northwestern University in Qatar. And what an exciting time to be in Qatar and to be in the region. I know everyone is thinking about the World Cup, so it's really an honor to have the time to speak to you guys about you know, my personal experience and my journey. Qatar is a very special place for me. It has a special place in my heart because I would say that some of my most formative years as a journalist were shaped as...
Your mic is off.
Sorry. I think as a journalist I would have figured that out. But they usually do that for me in the studio. I don't have to do these things.
All right. Do I need to start over, or was I projecting okay?
That's good.
Okay, great. I was saying Qatar has a very special place in my heart because some of my most formative years as a journalist and some of my most memorable experiences, and we can get into those later, were as a journalist for Al Jazeera English. And there's a very important lesson there, and we can talk about that later. But You mentioned my parents. My mother's Palestinian. My father is Egyptian. So, you know, people sometimes ask me about what does it feel like to talk about politics. I'm like, my parents are Egyptian and Palestinian. What do you think a dinner conversation was like growing up in the 80s and 90s, talking about everything going on in the world? So politics kind of came very natural to us, and I think a lot of people in this part of the world, it's not that hard. It's always on the forefront of our minds. But my parents immigrated to the U.S. when I was 5 years old, and we settled in Michigan at first, and it was freezing cold for people coming from Egypt. Not a natural climate for people like us. And so we actually ended going back to the Middle East for a couple more years in the 90s. And the reason why that's important in my own personal journey is that it was during the first Gulf War. And we were living in Jordan at the time. And I remember as a young kid watching the invasion and the war play out live on CNN. And it was really there that I began to get the journalism bug. In fact, I used to make home videos with my brother where we would go out and do like fake news reports on the streets of Amman with my cousins and stuff. And that's really where I began to get drawn to journalism as a possible career path.
Tell us a little bit about your training, right? So you did not study journalism in college. There's nothing wrong with that. This is NUQ.
So. Don't be discouraged if there's any journalism students here. There's hope.
And I learned this morning also that the two of us overlapped for a year at American University.
Yeah.
He was graduating. I was on my sort of one of my early academic jobs. So you studied international affairs in Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
What does that mean for somebody who becomes a journalist?
Oh, man, I don't know. You really don't make much with an international affairs degree, right? It's just like one of those degrees that you get to try to understand the world, but by the time you get it, the world has changed so much, so it's almost like, what did I just spend 4 years and, you know, $250,000 on and trying to figure it out? But it's not the specific, and I'll go back to your question more directly, which is, I studied international relations, and I was interning at NBC News, where I ended up working. But at the time, I actually wanted to go into filmmaking, is what I was drawn to, and I wanted to try to become a filmmaker. And I wasn't sure what career path I was going to do, so I was just doing international relations because I had just taken Model United Nations and Current Affairs in high school and was very much fascinated by the world and had spent, as I mentioned, my years between the Middle East and the U.S., so it was kind of on the forefront of my mind. American University in D.C. has an excellent School of International Service. They had a joint degree, so I was like, let's do it. And it was in Washington, which is a beautiful city and I love. I was interning at NBC in my final year of my degree when 9/11 happened, and the network did not have a lot, if any, Arabic speakers. And I was basically, I was a desk assistant, which is a very entry-level position, answering the phones, distributing mail to correspondents, things like that. It was not an exciting job, but you were in the newsroom, in the nerve center of the operation. And because of my linguistic skills, I was basically taken off of that assignment and thrown into the investigative unit where I started working on investigating the 9/11 attacks with much more experienced journalism. So I was fully immersed into the journalism part, the investigative journalism part, and then the following year, President Bush gave his infamous Axis of Evil speech where he identified Iraq and North Korea as part of the Axis of Evil, and most people read that as a sign that the U.S. was going to begin preparing to invade Iraq. And so at that point, I really had to kind of make a career decision, which was, do I walk away from journalism and try to pursue something else, or do I stay on in journalism? And at this time, all the networks in the U.S. were starting to beef up their presence in the Middle East and their coverage of this potential invasion. And I decided to go with it, and I jumped ship to CNN as a freelance producer.
So I don't recommend war and violence as a promotion, but this is what happened to you, basically, right? I mean, you mentioned that your knowledge of Arabic was a determining factor. I'm sure it wasn't the only one, right? I don't want us to, like, you were not just a communicative vessel. They clearly saw other things in you.
I'd like to think so.
Send you into the field. Yeah. But let's talk a little bit for a second about, you know, we think of, I know that your identity has been sort of a formative force in your career. So let's talk a little bit about language and identity, right? We think of language and identity as almost personal or cultural resources. But in some cases, they can be a mix of that and professional assets. Can you tell us a little bit, not only your knowledge of Arabic, but also your identity? How has it shaped your career? I don't want to assume it has, but I see that it has.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little more about this?
Sure. I think, you know, to go back to originally your first part of the question, yes, part of the reason because I spoke Arabic, I was able to start working on investigative parts with the team that was looking into 9/11. I think it evolved from there. So my senior producers also sent me on assignments to the region where they were like, this is somebody who can comfortably operate in the region, and operate meaning like you can get to the ground. And at the time, at a young age, it was mostly logistical, not very editorial, but it was nonetheless very important to be part of the team because the logistical aspect of broadcast production is extremely important. So in many of my early assignments, whether it was for NBC or CNN, it was being able to navigate the bureaucracies of production in the Middle East or in the region, which, as some of you know, are extremely challenging. And things are changing now because the technology has gotten easier. But that was, I think, important in me becoming more familiar with the region, and that just reinforced my the companies that I worked with to give me more and more opportunities. And I think for the question of identity, it's interesting. At different phases of my career, my identity plays an important role, and certainly has always been at the forefront of my ability to compare what I see happening in the US with what is happening overseas, and at the same time, provide commentary about the United States and its foreign policy because of my identity. I have lived in the places that I am talking about. When I critique policy in Israel, Palestine, or Gaza, it's because I lived there. When I lived in Egypt, I can see the results of American foreign policy. I can see it in Iraq. I saw it in the Middle East, elsewhere. I saw it in Libya, I see it in Syria. So being able to understand the language, know the region, understand the culture, have the historical context, understand the cultural sensitivities, all of those help in shaping the way I reported when I was a reporter, and now the way that I provide commentary and analysis, because my show now is less reporting and more perspective and more analysis and contextualization as opposed to straight factual reporting, which is what I did when I was a correspondent.
So tell us a little bit, this journey that you've made, I think represents what the journey that journalism, to a large extent, has made, which is from reporting to commentary and analysis, at least on television. Right? How has that affected journalism and how journalism covers the world?
That's a really good question, and I think it's probably good and bad. And I think we're in a very interesting inflection point generally, certainly in broadcast media, because information and facts have become ubiquitous, but I don't think we're necessarily becoming more knowledgeable. So I think people are becoming more aware of specific events that are happening, but are not investing in time to understand why these things happen. And what I would say is that my experience as a reporter helped me understand that there is a moment to understand what is happening, but sometimes it is as equally important to understand why something is happening. And I try to spend a little bit more time now focusing on the whys and trying to give my perspective and in situations where I can bring some insight from my reporting, I do that. But I think there's also a little bit of danger in that you can feel sometimes the trend is that people are looking for affirmation. So people who are watching you want to have their own views affirmed as opposed to challenged. And that is a little bit of a tricky slope in broadcast media because I speaking for myself, I want to be challenged. I want the people that I have on my program to push back sometimes against my ideas, and I challenge them and try to do it in a respectful way. And I think in those moments of challenging ideas, we get the best conversation and the most insightful conversation. But I think we are in a, and I speak again here for the US, but you can see it happening a little bit around the world. The society is becoming very polarized. And so people who are tuning in because they're like, I know that person is gonna say something I'm gonna agree with. And you watch it because they're affirming for you an idea that you hold. And if that's the case, then we're becoming more siloed in how we are consuming and processing information and context.
Absolutely. I remember, I think I may have mentioned it this morning, the very first time I received hate mail was, I was in DC at American University, and I went on the Diane Rehm show to explain what the entrance of Al Jazeera English, the emergence of it, means. And most of the audience was not interested in, they just saw this as a foreign body, therefore dangerous, therefore 50 hate mails within a day, nothing what NPR was subjected to by that. I see this happening now at the local level, even in the US. So it's not only the sort of, you know, here's an Arab or a Muslim or whatever people imagined, all kinds of stereotypes. But the level of polarization now, there's almost no issue you can discuss without people yelling at each other.
Yeah.
You know, I often say, now that I don't live in the US anymore, every time I'm in the United States and I watch cable, I feel the metaphor that comes to mind, people are barking at each other. They're not talking to each other. So your perspective seems to be a minority perspective. The idea to push back respectfully, the idea to be open to other approaches, to other perspectives on controversial topics. To what extent is this sustainable, right? To what extent the public does not seem to want informed, rational deliberation. It seems a lot of audience studies seem to suggest people want red meat that confirms their biases, that affirms their beliefs, that makes them feel better about themselves. So they're not watching journalists in order to, TV journalists and broadcasts in particular, to learn about the world, to get information, but to feel vindicated and affirmed.
Yeah, I don't want to make it as a generalization for all the viewers. I mean, it's something that is mindful. I do think that, you know, first of all, the United States is a big country. It's 330 million people. And you're talking about a very diverse media landscape between digital, broadcast, cable, print, radio. So all of these things have to be taken into consideration. So if we're just going to zero in on cable broadcast for a moment, and more specifically, perspective programming, which is different than news programming. You know, I fall into the category of what they call prime time programming in the US, which tends to be more opinionated, more perspective, and less just straight reporting. And I think sometimes people lose sight of that distinction because that's the part of the newspaper that's the opinion page. So when you're getting to my program at the end of the day at 8 o'clock at night, you are flipping the paper from news and you're getting into the opinion. So it's understandable that that part is Ayman's take. I mean, I think the show is named Ayman because it's like, I want to hear what Ayman has to say about this, or at least I'd like to think, or it's because I really hate that guy and I really want to know why he says the stupid things that he does say. So I feel like it can go both ways, right? But generally speaking, because the society is becoming more politically polarized, and there are things that are at stake that are on these very dangerous fault lines that we're seeing right now in America, people are feeling the need to watch and get information from people and sources that they feel are telling them something in their same worldview. So it's not necessarily entirely about, hey, he's gonna say what I want him to say, but it is gonna be, does this person understand the threat that I think we're going through as a country? Does this person realize what is the challenge that I am facing? But the one thing I always say to people, which is really the most important part, is so much of journalism depends on the consumer. And you know, we walk into a supermarket in the US and you have 100 different types of water to choose from. I mean, there's literally 100 different types of flavored water to choose from. And we spend so much time trying to understand what goes in our body and what we consume and how we consume it, and is it safe, and is it healthy, and is it vegan if it's vegetarian? And those are very important questions, but we don't spend as much time asking about the information that we're consuming. So I say the media has a tremendous responsibility, but in this day and age, consumers of information have a very important responsibility in terms of what they put in their minds as well.
I think, you know, when you mentioned the 100 types of water, they're all in plastic bottles.
Yeah.
Right? So
there's not one in paper. There's a paper bottle.
Yes. What the analogy is to the media landscape. Yeah. But let's switch gears, shift gears for a second. You've had many key moments in your career. You've interviewed leaders. You've covered wars. You've been the fever of the newsroom. Is there a memorable moment that really sticks in your mind that not only you remember it more than others, but that you feel was transformative for you?
I mean, yes, the short answer, I mean, without a doubt, the Arab Spring, and particularly the Egyptian Revolution in 2011, just because of the personal connection I had to Egypt and how I ended up covering that story and being there in the final day and the journey of those 18 days, and then the amount of hope and inspiration that came out of that moment, but also just because it was also very transformative for my life. At the time, I was working for, as I said, Al Jazeera English, and then after my coverage or our coverage of the Arab Spring, I think a lot of networks overseas, certainly in the West, took notice of Al Jazeera and said, can we draw on your expertise? Would you be willing to come back and work for us? And it was a full circle moment for me, because when I was a producer at CNN in 2006 and I wanted to become a correspondent, at the time CNN was like, you're not ready to be a correspondent. And Al Jazeera English was saying to me, come, we'll make you a correspondent. And some of my colleagues at CNN sat me down and were like, if you go to Al Jazeera English, you will never be hired by an American network again. And they were just like, their perspective was, this was Al Jazeera English in its pre-launch days. So people were looking at it saying, you're never gonna be able to get a job again in an American network. So I kind of took that with a grain of salt, and I went to go work for Al Jazeera English, and we had this incredible run, in journalistically speaking, of course. And so when I got those calls to come back and work for an American network, there was a moment of vindication. Yes. And it was very important for me to be able to make that statement. And I did not want to leave Al Jazeera English, but I also wanted to be able to make a statement about the quality of journalism that Al Jazeera English had produced and the quality of journalists that it had produced. And at the time, I was the first one, but now there are dozens of journalists who have been hired by Al Jazeera English who are now working in Western media outlets, some of them with me in my own network and all across the American media landscape. So I think it's a testament to the quality of journalists that Al Jazeera English produced.
And you have your own eponymous show on primetime on a major.
Yes.
that's a big deal. So we both mentioned Al Jazeera English. So I want to move to some broader themes now, right? So those of us who study the media and journalism, there's decades from, you know, World War II onwards, and even before, it goes back to World War I actually, where news flow, information flows globally, in one direction, right? It's typically, we had the four dominant press agencies for a while. You have, you know, in the US, it used to be the three networks. And coverage of the world tends to be, or tended to be, by Western news organizations that then was fed back to the places they were covering. This has changed, right? And Al Jazeera played, I think, a major role in it. I think of Al Jazeera English coverage of Africa, which, yeah, showcased the weaknesses, for example, of the BBC that used to do that very well. So there has been some change. Do you think change is significant? When you're at a major network in the US, do you think of, oh, this is too US-centric, I need to broaden the frame of what's going on in the world and take into account the stories and lives and events that may not be of direct interest to US viewers or news consumers, but are nonetheless important for millions, if not billions, of other people?
Yes, the only thing is, and not to disagree with that, but I remind people all the time that our network and other networks in the US are not international networks.
Yes.
And by I would argue by power of, I don't know if hegemony is the right word, but just by the desire of always consuming American culture and media and politics. Yes, our network is broadcast around the world, but we don't program our shows because it's a global audience that we're speaking to. And that's a very important distinction, because when you're working for Al Jazeera English, when you're working for BBC World, when you're working for CNN International, you are putting out a program that you're like, this matters to the entire world. So you're trying to think of, what does an English speaker in India care? What does an English speaker in Kenya care? What does an English speaker in Mexico care? So it's a very different programming mentality than when you are an American cable news network covering America for Americans, but at times say, this is a very important international story, I have to cover it for an American audience. And that's, I think, where I try to keep that world perspective. Because of my background, because of what I've done in the past, I don't lose sight of what is happening overseas. So I may have a different bar than, let's say, some of my other colleagues in terms of what qualifies as an important international story, but I am still thinking about, how can I explain the story to an American audience? An American audience may not know the nuances of every Palestinian faction. They may not know the difference between Fatah and Hamas, or like what is who, which political faction in this part of the world represents what and what does what. But if I was doing that for Al Jazeera, I almost kind of have a baseline assumption that, like, yes, most of the people who are watching this understand that. And so I'm starting from a different point when I'm speaking to an American audience. So I definitely keep in mind what is happening around the world, and I will focus on some things that I think are important that the American audience needs to know, based on American government's involvement, American taxpayer money involvement, something that will have implications for American citizens and American security. But it's important to not lose sight of what is happening in the world.
Thank you. So one more thing about this. We hear often that the Middle East is no longer important in global geopolitics. We heard this after the Gulf War, right? Then the Arab uprisings happened, and the Middle East was plunged back to the center. Then we're hearing the same thing, in the US in particular, right? The pivot towards Asia, the rise of China and India, and all that. Do you agree with that assessment?
No, I don't agree with that.
Can you tell us a little more? Because this, I think, goes to the heart of how you decide that a global story is newsworthy to a US audience.
Well, first of all, I think the answer speaks for itself. The United States is so heavily invested in the Middle East, so it's definitely not a part of the world that the US is not interested in. I mean, security-wise, politically, diplomatically, there's probably no other region in the world that the United States has as many commitments as it does, and obligations, and various different events going on at any given point in the Middle East. So beyond the energy debate, which is always right now at the forefront of everyone's mind in terms of like oil prices and gas prices, economic trade, global trade flows through this region, the amount of potential that exists in this region, the human capital that exists in this region is at the forefront of, I think, every American policymaker. Sure, they're concerned about China, but it's for a different reason. And there's obviously the concern about what's happening in Russia. But I think what America does speaks volumes as to what America thinks. And you can see what America's doing in the region is still a sign that it is very much on the forefront of the US is thinking.
What about then what America says? Because I feel it's a bipartisan. What's the?
I don't know what America says. Nobody knows what America says, right?
When leaders say that the East is no longer important, right? Yeah. Why do they say that when they know it's not the case? I think this is, to me, this is a media information representation issue, right? Why do they feel the need to say we're pivoting away from the Middle East? Because there's an assumption and all its problems and all its violence, and right? And we need to pivot to China, which is the real rival. So it's almost as if interest is about whether there's a threat or not, and not about anything else.
Maybe. I mean, it could also be political calculation, which is, what is an easier selling point for domestic political consumption? If you're an American politician who is trying to garner votes and you want to show that you're trying to, hypothetically, you're coming out of 20 years of war in Afghanistan and Iraq, which were absolute disasters for your country, and you're trying to run on a policy of change, and you're trying to say, hey, I want to look forward. I don't want to be talking about Afghanistan and how much we lost in Afghanistan, both soldier-wise, monetary-wise, or in Iraq, or what we've done to the region, or what we've done in Libya, or what we've done in Syria, or what has happened in Iran. So you can't run on defending those policies, so you say, forget those policies, let's talk about what we really need to be focused on. So I can see that there's a political calculation just as much as there probably is a futuristic calculation, which is you do have to be aware, rightfully so, that Russia and China remain, as American politicians have said, either adversaries or at various points threats or competitors. So there is that is a reality, but I also think that there's a political calculation as to why the rhetoric makes it sound like we're not interested in the Middle East, when in reality, on the ground, America's still very much interested in the Middle East, you know?
Speaking of politicians.
If America wasn't interested in the Middle East, President Biden would not have gone to Saudi Arabia when everyone told him not to go to Saudi Arabia.
Excellent point. So you haven't held back, against US politicians, particularly running for office, who you've characterized as anti-democratic. Can you tell us a little bit from your unique perch as a primetime major show host that provides commentary and analysis? What's going on now in the United States, in US politics? You have 30 seconds to explain US politics to us. But you know.
Sorry, I can't hear the question. I'm sorry. I have to. No, I'm joking.
You can stick to sort of a media perspective. Like, how do you cover somebody who suddenly is completely out of a system of belief that the media system is built on?
So I think there's two things I would say, and these are two, I think, very important points. One, there is a tendency to think of America as a long-standing democratic country, and I think that's false. America has been an independent country since 1776. It has been practicing some form of democracy since then, but it has not been practicing a multicultural democracy for all of its citizens really since the 1960s. So in some ways, America is a young democracy. It's an old institutional democracy, but it doesn't really count if for 150 years your stability was because you excluded everybody except white men from running your country. That's not a challenge when you only have one demographic to create a democracy for. Since the 60s, since America became a multicultural democracy where everybody had a right to participate, and certainly before that with women participating in the democracy, the story's a little bit different. And I think if you put that in the proper context, you could understand that America's democracy is new, it's a little bit fragile, and it's a lot of hard work. And you can understand that the same forces of authoritarianism and totalitarianism that existed elsewhere in the world can find a way into American politics. So, you know, I've become a little bit more vigilant about that because I understand that I still believe in democracy. I still think democracy is the best form of governance. But I also understand that there are ways to manipulate democracy, and there are ways that you can use democracy to bring anti-democratic forces into power. And we're seeing that happen right now in the US. It's not the first time it has happened in the US, but I see that happening right now in the US where people are openly questioning, openly questioning elections, the integrity of elections, whether or not these elected officials, once they come into power, are willing to overturn the results of an outcome. We see some very dangerous cases that are working their way to the US Supreme Court that could potentially change the way that the American electoral system, which by the way needs to be reformed before this Supreme Court decision even gets ruled on. But there are all kinds of problems with the electoral challenge, the Electoral College. And the people who designed the American system in 1776 with 13 colonies designed it for a time in which the population of the country and the disparities between states was not as vast as it is today. And so you have to ask yourself whether it makes sense that you have a democracy in which one party represents 40 million more people than the other party based on the number of senators they have, and yet they have the same balance, if not sometimes opposite balance, not an imbalance, if you will, of representation in the political system, you know?
So speaking of representation and sort of the opening up of representation in the US, what do you make of all the recent shows that feature some pretty prominent Arab American characters, right? I'm thinking of Mo, Rami.
Oh.
One of the most interesting, so I haven't seen Mo yet. I want to preface this.
Great show.
Please don't spoil it.
Oh, okay.
but one of the, I read one of the most interesting things I've read about it, because this is what you do if you're a media scholar. You read everything there is to read before you actually watch the film. Is a review in The New Yorker that says what makes it so good is the fact that there is no pretension to show Mo as a likable character, that he can be sleazy, calculating, manipulative of people around him, that he can be a jerk, basically.
Yeah.
Right? So do you agree that the representations of Arab Americans, Muslim Americans, has become more sophisticated in the US in popular culture? I'm not speaking about news.
Yeah, I think, I mean, the short answer is yes, it's become more real. And I think you're seeing Arab characters in their complexities. You're seeing Arab characters in their faults. You're seeing Arab characters in their limitations. And you're seeing Arab characters in their similarities. And in fact, Rami's show has this very interesting appeal. I have two really good friends of mine who live in Nashville who are a little bit more traditionally conservative Americans, white Americans, and they were obsessed with that show because it spoke to them in a way that their own upbringing was, this constant tension between their religion and how they practice their religion and how they incorporate religion into their life. And then the reality of what they were living every day in America and how they were trying to juggle and balance that, which I think all of us, to some extent, go through. So I think what these shows do is they break a barrier in being able to speak to people about the, I would qualify those shows as uniquely Arab American experiences, not necessarily Arab experiences. And I think that's an important point because it may be lost on this part of the world, but at the same time, it will speak to this part of the world in some ways. But those are uniquely Arab American experiences that I think are breaking new grounds and getting people and audiences to say, hey, they're just like me.
You know, at the same time, Rami, for example, with Mr. Robot at the beginning, I mean, it's also very important to see them in roles that are not Arab Americans.
Yeah, you're talking about Rami Malek.
They're great actors as well.
Yeah.
And of course, the irony is that you become successful and then you're cast as the evil foe of James Bond and you die. That's in no time.
Or you become one of the most iconic music legends in Bohemian Rhapsody and you win an Oscar. So I think, I mean, he's just a talent on another level, that guy. In whatever he acts, he's just unbelievable, you know what I mean?
So this is a great note to open it up. I think I've really enjoyed our couple of conversations today, but it's time to open it up to questions, comments. So please, you can, yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, I think media, like anything else, like any industry, evolves. So I think terminology evolves. I mean, you could just look back at 100 years ago and the language that was used in American media to describe minorities in America and how they described all kinds of other different groups, whether or not the language that was used afforded them respect to the people they were covering or not. And I think that you would see over time the language has evolved. And that's, I think anyone who studies linguistics understands that, you know? So it's no surprise that the language of conflict also evolves. I think when you're talking about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, there is such a heightened sensitivity around it and the terminology that is used, because you're also dealing with another side that is aggressively and much more competently involved in shaping the narrative around the conflict. And I think that makes it very difficult for journalists to understand, because you're competing with narratives and you're competing with the reality on the ground. And so unless you're a journalist who goes and sees the reality on the ground, it's understandable why you would then fall trapped to a specific narrative about the conflict. And that's the thing I try to challenge people to do, is like, if you're going to report on the conflict, go see what is happening on the ground before you just use language that is used by one side over the other. That's the most important thing. And I apologize, I forgot the second part of your question, if you can just remind me about.
It's just the form of word.
Yeah, I think so. I think you're seeing a lot more diversity in the newsroom, and it's something that organizations are increasingly committed to. So when you have more diversity in the newsroom, you're going to get different viewpoints represented in the coverage. But also because the world is now much more interconnected, you cannot ignore what is happening in places like the Global South and just pretend that it's not happening. Now when things are happening, even if you don't have journalists on the ground, you're able to see firsthand from social media and eyewitnesses and local journalists what is happening, and that I think also turns around and shapes the coverage.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think, I mean, the media landscape is changing so rapidly, and certainly, you know, Twitter is, or social media in general, is, I think, both a force for good and a force for bad, because obviously, as we've seen, and you can easily document, sometimes a lie will spread much faster than the truth, and people have documented fictitious reports that have gone viral, and then people tried to correct it, and you can see just the number of people who have shared or retweeted a lie versus the number of people who've reposted or reshared the truth or the correction. Is always there's a disparity. So it's a bit of a challenge. I think, you know, in my case, I use Twitter selectively. I try not to use it superficially. Like, I try not to use it just to score cheap political points. I'm probably sure I'm guilty of that at some point here and there, when I'm like, I just want to make like a snarky comment. But I try to use it a little bit more selectively than just giving like a quick snarky comment here for like likes or shares or reaction. But it's a challenge, and I think we're still kind of learning our way and navigating the balance between how to use it. I think it's very naive to say like, social media does no good and I'm not going to use social media. We probably wouldn't be able to see what is happening in Iran right now if we didn't have access to social media. So that's important. But it's also important to be able to say, is every video that I'm looking at really happening in Iran? Is every video that I'm looking at authentically happening, and not from a couple years ago or a different event, or even maybe even in some cases a different country? And we see that happen a lot in Syria and Gaza and elsewhere, when things were going viral and really being very emotive and you know, drawing a reaction, people would say like one way or the other, they'd say like, look what's happening right now in the world is not reacting, or the false, which is like, oh, see, that video is false, they're all liars, there's no suffering there. And you have to kind of be very careful with that. So I think it's a balance that we're still working on getting right, and we have to keep working on.
Thank you.
I think that, first of all, I think it's very normal in a very basic human level to have an opinion about everything. Every one of us in this room has an opinion about everything. We have an opinion about what food we like. We have an opinion about what we like to wear, what we don't like to wear, what shows we like, what shows we don't like, what music we listen to. So having an opinion is actually not a bad thing. And we all consult each other every day when I say, like, hey, what's a show that you've just watched that's good, and you give me your opinion, and I'm like, oh, great, I want to watch that Netflix show because you gave me your opinion that you really liked it. And I may watch the first episode and be like, this sucks, I'm not watching it. And then you watch another episode and you like. So the idea of opinions is not controversial. Whether or not journalists should have opinions depends on which journalists and whether or not the news organizations provide a variety of content for their viewers, which is why I made that comparison to the opinion page of a newspaper. You know that you're reading the news on certain pages and you're getting a certain factual report, and then you're getting the op-ed section either from a person who has spent some time formulating that opinion or the editorial board of the news organization. And it's the same in broadcast. People who are giving their opinion, whether it is a dangerous opinion like we see people like Tucker Carlson give every night on American TV, or whether it is an informed opinion by somebody who is studied and opining about a subject matter expertise that they have. But at the end of the day, as long as that distinction is made, it is up to the viewers to say, you know what, I want to hear somebody else's opinion. Here's my opinion, but I want to hear what this other person has to say about it. And this is a person I like because, or don't like, because they are challenging me, or they're forcing me to think outside the box, or because they're presenting very coherent, succinct arguments. Now, we're talking about a landscape that includes hundreds of people, and now when you include social media and YouTube, you're talking about like tens of thousands of people. I mean, there are people that have zero expertise, but they're very good at giving their opinion because they kind of speak in a way that's relatable and they share their life experiences and people watch them. So the people are like tuned into opinion. And I think that's okay. That's not something that we should say is not good or is not healthy. I think people having opinion is human nature, you know?
I think, Abe, did you have your hand up earlier? Oh, okay. Claudia?
That's a good question. I think that, I mean, to counter polarization? Yeah, I mean, that's a really good question because I think it really depends on what you envision as being the role of the media, right? Like, is the role of the media to have town halls of people from both sides? I'm not a big fan of both sidesism, and I think that's kind of dangerous sometimes, especially when you're dealing with some of the threats that you're seeing in the US. I do think you have to be challenged to say, can you hear and listen to what the other side is saying and evaluate whether or not that threat is real and whether that risk is real. So I think the one thing the American media has to do generally is slow down a little bit. I think in the news cycle of 24/7, it's really just like so fast, sometimes lacks a lot of depth. You're always chasing one conversation after the other because the conversations, there's just so much, there's so much intensity, and you want to try to cover everything that sometimes you don't have enough time to cover everything in depth. Again, I'm speaking here very broadly, right? I'm not singling out any one style of format or show or anything like that. So I think if we were able to take a minute and have a pause and, you know, slow things down, you'd probably get a slightly different result and not just be limited to what you know is the news of the day, you know, that you're not just chasing the commentary of the moment, but being able to take a step back and say, yes, I know this is happening, but I want to spend a little bit of time to talk about this slowly and more in depth with a variety of viewpoints, you know?
Thank you. Sam?
Yeah, thank you for a fascinating discussion. You mentioned just now, don't always have time to cover everything in depth. So I'm wondering how, when you have to make those difficult decisions, what you're going to focus on and cover in your show, how you make that choice. Do you have a kind of gut instinct, you've got to talk about this? Do you think this is going to appeal to the audience? Do you think, okay, this is what everyone's talking about, so I could join the conversation? Or do you have some kind of personal criteria that leads to those decisions?
Yeah, no, it's also a really good question. You know, fortunately, we have a really good team of producers, and it's a very collaborative process. So there are definitely moments when I tip the scale a little bit personally for a story that I am passionate about, or, you know, I've interviewed both Rami and Mo, and those are two characters because of shows that I have a personal connection to, and I think they're stories that need to be amplified, and I want to bring them to a larger audience. I will say I really want to interview these two subjects, and in that case, we interviewed them. And then there are definitely times where a producer of mine will present an idea in our meeting and say, hey, there's a really interesting angle to this conversation, or we should look at X, Y, and Z, and we talk about it collaboratively, and we say, that's interesting, that's a take that we haven't heard, that's a different type of perspective on that story, and we bring it to the show. So there's those, and then there are definitely, hey, it's the midterms. Everybody's talking about the midterms in the US. I can't just ignore the midterms and turn around and say, like, no, I'm going to spend, like, you know, talk about the devaluation of a currency overseas, because I think it's important when the US midterms are happening. That would kind of be also like malpractice on my part for my show and for my audience. So it's a combination of all of those things. Some of them are dictated by just the severity of the moment we find ourselves in. Some of it is, I think this is a unique angle or a unique perspective or a conversation or a person I want to speak to. And some of it is the team that works on the show coming in and saying, hey, we think this is a really good topic. It's not getting enough attention. Let's try to spotlight it with the platform that we have.
So we have time for one last question. Yes.
Hi.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you're talking about it on a local level, I think you have to rely on a little bit of the local news in the community that you live in. And I think you have to do, as I was saying earlier, you have to do your part in identifying reliable sources of fact-based information, whether that includes newspapers or online sources or primary sources. Look, I don't expect anyone to have the time to sit there and watch an entire congressional hearing that could be like 4 hours about, you know, energy prices or gas prices. So that's not what I'm suggesting, but I am sure that there are enough outlets out there that are providing accurate summaries of those hearings, and you have to be able to find them and read them. And if you're wondering something a little bit deeper than what came out of this hearing and something more along the lines of like, why is this hearing important or what does this mean for my community? You will be able to find that analysis and that opinion. You may not find it on the pages of that same newspaper, but you may find it somewhere else. I mean, I don't think there's a shortage of access to both information analysis and opinion right now. It's just curating it.
Does that make it harder to find?
Yes, 100%. Unfortunately, algorithms have become a major part of our problem in what you're seeing. And so you have to kind of navigate against the algorithm. You know what I mean? You have to... Yeah, it's definitely a challenge. But if you're just relying on social media, then that's why I'm saying it becomes a problem, right? Which is like, if you want to just wake up and scroll through your feed, you're only probably going to get the things that you're interacting with. Whereas if you take the deliberate initiative of saying, I am going to read these three newspapers every morning. I'm going to read a newspaper from the Global South. I'm going to go read a paper from Europe, and I want to read something from the US. Hypothetically, I'm just, you know, making something up. But if you, depending on how you want to curate your sourcing of information, you put together your own pattern of consuming information, if that makes sense, you know? So, for example, like, I wake up every day, I don't have time to read, 30 different websites, otherwise I'd never get anything done. But I will wake up and I will check a handful of international websites that I trust are gonna give me a good glimpse of what is happening in the world, whether it is Al Jazeera English or BBC World or The Guardian or The Washington Post or The New York Times, something that's happening in Asia. Just to get a glimpse of it. And then if there's something else that I want to do a deep dive in, I will kind of zero in on that more and more. So if you're interested in a particular subject matter or a region, I think what I would recommend is, instead of relying on like whether or not social media is going to present that to you, is to wake up and say, I want to follow this story, and I'm going to be interested in it, and I want to learn where the best sources of information about this topic are, whether it's business or environment or sports or fashion or politics or what have you, you know? It what? It sucks? Why? Because you have to do your own work?
Yeah,
believe me, I know, it sucks that like nobody wants to do their own work. But you do go, I mean, I guess like when you do go, I don't know if you guys have Instacart here or like Amazon for your grocery deliveries. But at the end of the day, you're still choosing what you put in the box that you get delivered, no? That's interesting. I haven't done the zebra experiment, but I will.
But I think.
But if you're looking for like, are African zebras the same? And like, let's say, I don't know. It's like they're different.
So I think concluding with the necessity of always one doing one's own work to figure out what's going on in the world and not just passively
consuming information.
Consuming things is a very good way to end. Yeah. Thank you very much for being
thank
with us.
So
we hope it's not the last time.
No, hopefully it will not be. Thank you so much.
And thank you all for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. We can continue outside. There are people who
love
have
to.
Classes, and so they
love to, absolutely.
Thank you.
Hi, how are you? Yes, how are you doing?
Yeah.